We have two wonderful physical theories. General relativity that describes the world on a macro scale, and a quantum theory that describes the world very well on a micro scale. Due to the fact that gravitational phenomena at the current density of matter have a negligible impact on the behavior of elementary particles and atoms, when describing the micro world, we ignore gravity, and when describing the macro world, we ignore quantum phenomena because they have practically no significance on this scale. However, both theories break down at the densities of matter just after the Big Bang and inside black holes. Both theories must be applied to explain these states of matter, but they are irreconcilable in present form. General relativity describes a plastic and continuous space that can be bent by matter, and in quantum theory, space is only a stage where particles interact with each other. We need quantum theory of gravity. So far, none of the attempts to reconcile these theories has been successful. The most promising are string theory and loop quantum gravity. Today, we'll talk about loop quantum gravity. The loop quantum gravity assumes that space has an atomic structure. The geometry of a space appears continuous, but is actually woven from one-dimensional quantum threads. They are only 10 to minus 34 meters, so they are so close to each other that they look like a continuous space. The loop quantum gravity equations tell us how these strands interact, how they interact with matter. Basically, there is matter and geometry. During the expansion of the universe, the number of network nodes in which there is matter remains constant, while the number of empty nodes changes. The idea is that we have a network. Electrons, protons, neutrons, or quarks can only be found in the nodes of this network. But these nodes are the nodes of the graph. The lines that come out of the nodes are these quantum threads. What exists can move along the strands of this lattice, such as photons, which carry the electromagnetic force between molecules. Molecules we call mediators, this is photons and gluons, live on these quantum strands. In most cases, when the density of matter is low, like on the Earth or in the center of the Sun, we still consider this density to be low, space-time is curved, but not curved enough for quantum effects to matter. But as we approach the Big Bang, where the gravitational field becomes almost infinite, the curvature of space-time becomes almost infinite, then these quantum effects become more and more important, the atomic structure becomes very significant. From the perspective of the loop theory of gravity, we can see that while the equations of general relativity work very well until the density of matter is less than 1/100th of Planck's density, this is 10 to 80 times the density of atomic nucleus, this is really a lot, then the equations of general relativity do not work at all, and the equations of the loop quantum gravity should be taken into account. General relativity tries to describe smooth spacetime and it just tears apart. But there are still threads, so we can talk about what's going on with them all the time. And the theory of loop quantum gravity tells us what happens to these threads. The physics of the loop quantum gravity does not break down. We can calculate what happened. One of the discoveries was that as we move towards the Big Bang and begin to describe everything in terms of the basic building blocks of space, it turns out that there was another universe before the Big Bang. The current one and the one before the Big Bang are connected by a quantum bridge. This quantum bridge is described with great accuracy by completely new physics. As we move from the distant past before the Big Bang, we see the universe collapsing. Matter becomes denser and more quantum phenomena begin to emerge. When we come to 1% of Planck density, then a new repulsive force emerges at the level of quantum geometry that no one has ever thought of before. It was proved by computer simulations. This was indeed the result predicted by the loop quantum gravity. That gravity is not always attractive was a really surprising discovery. It turns out that the atoms of space don't like to be packed too tightly, so there is a slight repulsive force between them, which is usually completely negligible. But when we compress these atoms of geometry too tightly, when the density reaches 1/100th of Planck's density, then the force becomes enormous and causes an explosion. This explosion looks like a Big Bang in all respects, but it is not. The difference is that it is described exactly in the equations of the loop quantum gravity, while at the moment of the Big Bang, classical physics ceases to work. Repulsive forces of this kind are known in physics. One of them, with roots in quantum mechanics, has its source in the Pauli exclusion principle. Basically, the point is that when we take two fermions, such as electrons, they cannot be put in one place. When stars like the Sun burn out their nuclear fuel, they begin to collapse. we know that at 2 times the mass of the Sun, the star will collapse, but because it is not possible to collect all the elementary particles in one place, a new repulsive force arises that produces a neutron star, very compact, a pulsar. So, we can have a repulsive force coming from quantum physics. But it comes from matter, this new repulsive force, which was discovered with the loop quantum gravity, is not a property of matter, but of geometry itself. It is many times greater than any other force known to us. Even when the mass of matter is equal to the mass of the entire universe, this force still wins and pushes back elementary particles. When the pre-Big Bang universe collapsed and the density of matter exceeded Planck's, the repulsive force overcame gravity and reflected. So, the Big Bang is replaced with a quantum bounce, and loop quantum gravity precisely describes the nature of this reflection.